Ignition sequence starts. 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. Liftoff. We have a liftoff.
Hey everybody, this is the Digital Asset Investor, and last night I went camping, and I've been dragging today. I don't think I slept very well, but I have been putting together a lot of good stuff for you, and so here we go. Let's hit the refresh button on this bad boy, and here we go. Now remember, this is from August 9th, 2018, 2 months after the Ethereum free pass, Ryan Selkis, founder and CEO of Messari. Now remember, this guy is a Bitcoin maxi of Bitcoin maxis, and he hates anything that is Ripple and XRP. But in this clip, he is telling truth, okay? And he's not directly naming Ethereum, but he's not directly naming Ethereum. But I wanted to remind you that when it wasn't just Ethereum getting a free pass. It was they were basically. After that point, they were allowed to have a token factory and have had that ever since then. They're issuing them at will, and it's in their quote framework that they got together with the SEC and gave themselves. So, and kept all other industry participants out. We don't have any indication that anybody was at the table except people that were Ethereum investors and representatives. And I hope somebody can prove me wrong, but I don't think they can. Listen to this.
What are the things that bother you the most or disturb you the most about like what's going on in the crypto space today?
We claim that it's decentralized and equitable and it's all about the technology, and that's all bullshit. Just cover to cover. It's just not true. Most of these tokens that are being...
And remember, the whole argument for Bill Hinman giving Ethereum the free pass was that, oh, this is decentralized, and it's somehow decentralized and all these others aren't.
Holds are being, held by the same syndicate of investors. It gets them, early access to all the deals. It's probably not decentralized. They're getting massive discounts. So, by the time the retail investors actually have an opportunity to purchase these, very often they're buying it, 10 or 20 or 50x multiple of what the insiders are paying. And these things are trading publicly with massive information asymmetries, where the investors, even when they are liquid, right, even when they're trading on exchanges, like the insiders of the projects, the investors that have gotten early, they just have a different level of access to information than anyone else that's buying through Binance or Bitfinex or Coinbase or Gemini.
All right, okay. Now BitBoy tweeted this out today. I'm all in on this. $4 XRP is nothing compared to what it will be when this SEC thing is over. We are going to be validated. Now just wait until Ripple goes public. So I played this video the other day for you, so I'm not going to play that again, but he's doubling down. Now, the Joker, we've got some news here. The Joker sent me a message, or I think maybe I saw a tweet. This guy, it says Jokes No More Made. I don't know if he changed his handle or I don't think this is a different person. I think it's the same person. But anyway, I saw that he said he was retiring. Because of crypto, he was officially retiring. And so I was going to give him the title. We don't have this title on this channel yet. He is the official trader who retired from because of crypto of the Digital Asset Investor channel. anyway, he says, you ready for XRP fireworks? I posted this green fractal a while ago. Since then, XRP follows the green fractal like a clock. Amazing. Let's rock and roll. And here it is. Okay. But then he says something even more interesting. I have to raise my target for XRP from $14 to $18. He's got his numbers circled. Look at that. Okay. Interesting stuff. Now, the official cool guy of the Digital Asset Investor channel has weighed in today, too.
All right, Mr. Gasparino, we got to have a little Columbus Day roundtable. I keep hearing something that I think is wrong. So people, if I'm wrong, please correct me. Now, if Ethereum and Ripple raise money and form their company the same way,
yes,
we're asking the right question. Why is Ripple being treated differently? But I don't think they form their company and raise money the same way, Mr. Gasparino. Let's take oil, for example. Two options. One, you got this rare oil. Nobody can use it right now. I come to you, I say, buy this cheap, rare oil, and one day it's going to be worth a lot. And with the money you buy it with, we're going to build out, me and my buddies, this technology where then soon everybody can use this rare oil. And then you can sell it for a profit, or you can use it, but you're buying it because it's going to increase in value a lot. Sounds like a security to me. Option number two. I got this oil. I got the best oil. And I come to you and I say, buy this oil and your machines will run perfect. By the way, your competitor can buy this oil too, and their machines can run perfect. So you're buying it for utility. Sounds like a commodity. I got good oil. Buy it. So option number one, that rare oil, that's what Ethereum did, Mr. Gasparino. They had this oil. No one could use it. It was so cheap. People gave them money. They built out the tech. And then the people that bought that rare oil saw the prices soar, and they made profits. Option number two, Ripple raised money through venture capitalists to build that technology. Then, yes, they might have sold some XRP they had, but that was to partners for their operations to run efficiently. And their competitors could have bought the XRP too. It wasn't rare. You could use it. It makes your machines run faster and better. Okay, it's like a commodity. And yes, Brad and Chris might have sold some XRP on open exchanges, but I could have bought that. You don't know who's on the other side of that. It's an exchange.
Well, the other thing is, these guys, Joseph Lubin, that nobody knows what, it's been a complete secret what's going on over there at Consensus and what they hold and who they sold it to. Even since the Ethereum, has anybody ever seen who the buyers and the sellers were of Ethereum at the ICO when they had their pre-sale? I don't think anybody's ever known anything. In fact, we've shown a clip on this channel where Brad Garlinghouse and Joseph Lubin are sitting on a stage together, and Brad Garlinghouse is talking about how Ripple's been very transparent, and Joseph Lubin basically says that, well, you know, that's our company's information or whatever. And I mean, it was like bizarre. Okay, now, folks, if this is your first, if you never come to crypto Twitter ever again, and you can only read one thread, if you can only read one thread when you come to crypto Twitter, this is the thread. I'll put it this way. I'm going to make John Deaton's thread here. This is the official greatest thread ever shown on the Digital Asset Investor channel. John knocked it out of the park, grand slam, big time with this one this morning. In fact, I woke up in the middle of the night, or like, I don't know when he put, let's see when he put it out at 11:15 last night. So I woke up in the middle of the night and I read through this, or this morning, maybe early, like 4 a.m. or something. And I was looking at this going, wow. Okay. I'm not going to go through the whole thing because it's so long, but you've got to. This is not something that's optional. Go to @JohnEDeaton1, and I want you to go through the whole freaking thing. I literally read it to my dad, the whole thread, this morning. I'm going to just go through the first few of these, but by the time you get through this thing, you will literally start to smell something really bad. You may actually have a bad smell going up your nostrils because it affects you that much. I mean, it's that bad. These are the facts, and they are not in dispute. May 23rd, 2017, Clayton agrees to recuse himself from voting on any matter related to his law firm's Sullivan and Cromwell clients. November 30th, 2017, Lubin and Consensus announced the Brooklyn Project. December 13th, 2017, Hinman has a meeting with Lubin and Consensus and lawyers from Sullivan and Cromwell, Clayton's law firm. December 14th, 2017, Matt Korva of Consensus, along with lawyers from Sullivan and Cromwell, state that they are building an alliance with the SEC. January 25th, Clayton meets with Andreessen Horowitz, instructs them to put together a group and write up a memo. Perkins Coy, a member of the Ethereum Alliance, leads Enterprise Ethereum Alliance, leads the group of Ether investors. March 12, 2018, Brad Garlinghouse speaks publicly about Ripple using XRP to replace Swift. May 26, 2018, Perkins Coy sends Hinman the memo and Safe Harbor proposal. The only crypto asset mentioned in the Safe Harbor is Ether. Ether investors on the 28th meet secretly with Hinman, asking for a regulatory free pass from the SEC. April 19th, the meeting is leaked, and Nathaniel Popper, who we'll talk about in a little bit, he reports Ether investors seek non-security designation from the SEC. April 23rd, Gary Gensler comments that Ripple, Ethereum, and crypto need more regulatory clarity. April 23rd, SEC meets again with Lubin and Consensus. May 10th, on Liz Claman, Charles Gasparino reports the Brooklyn Project and Consensus, along with Joseph Lubin, are working closely with regulators to create a self-regulatory body being sanctioned by the SEC. The Brooklyn Project attempts to correct Gasparino's report. Gasparino rebukes this attempt and tweets out he knows what he was told by Andrew Keys about the SEC. May 12, 2018, Lubin says he is making great strides with regulators. May 24th, Lubin claims he can issue tokens in ways detailed in Hinman's speech, which hasn't happened yet. June 5th, Mike Novogratz, close friends with Lubin, says he will bet dimes to donuts the SEC will declare present-day Ether not a security. The speech is 9 days away. Novogratz also predicts SEC will soon pick a token and go after it. The speech was attached to 63 emails. June 8th, Consensus meets with SEC again, and Lubin says the market needs SEC to scare certain projects away. June 13th, a memo analyzing whether XRP is a security is passed among SEC staff. SEC refuses to turn it over because it's likely inconclusive XRP is a security. June 14th, Hinman's speech, which declares putting aside the fundraising of Ethereum's ICO, Ether is not a security. After Hinman, Lubin appears on the same stage claiming he wasn't able to read through Bill's entire speech and asks if Hinman spoke about XRP at all. The moderator responds that XRP wasn't mentioned, and Lubin replies, "That's interesting," as if he doesn't know anything. June 26, Brad Garlinghouse notes that Coinbase announced it was listing Ethereum Classic 2 days before the speech. June 26, Lubin tells the Domino he believes Ripple XRP is massively overvalued. Folks, you keep reading through this thing. I want you to read it. I want you to read it a second time and a third time. Then what I want you to do is retweet this thing 50,000 times if you have to, because this right here is devastating for only truth reasons, because what he's got in here is facts. He's got facts in here, and they are disturbing facts. Now, here's another one. This was one of the pieces of the thread. On August 25th, 2020, Consensus acquires Quorum from JP Morgan, and Lubin says his Quorum acquisition offering is an interbank information network that's similar to what Swift does, and adds that Consensus supports JP Morgan's own stablecoin, JPM coin, a direct competitor to Ripple and XRP. All right, you can't forget this. It wasn't just Ethereum that got a free pass. It was not anything, but Ethereum, to my knowledge, is one of the only platforms that can issue digital assets now and not get SEC scrutiny. Joseph Lubin has bragged in multiple videos about how they're issuing tokens and they've got this framework. What he doesn't say is that it's only for Ethereum and nobody else is included. But then you got this. Now, one thing I've noticed over the last few weeks, I've started to see articles where JP Morgan's talking about, they're really talking about Ethereum and all this. And you're starting to hear this narrative of, we think Ethereum can jump Bitcoin. And then today, I saw this pop up out of nowhere. Jamie Dimon comes up and says this.
I personally think that Bitcoin is worthless, but I don't want to be a spokesman. I don't care. It makes no difference to me. Our clients are adults. They disagree. That's what makes markets. So if they want to have access to buy or sell Bitcoin, you know, it's hard. We can't custody it, but we can give them legitimate, as clean as possible access.
Now, here's what we know about J.P. Morgan, because Joseph Lubin said so. The first thing we know is that Joseph Lubin had a piece of paper in his pocket before before Ethereum was launched. We don't know what was on the piece of paper or who gave it to him, but we know he had a piece of paper. We also know, because he said it, that J.P. Morgan was involved with Ethereum before the Ethereum token launch. He said it. I've shown the video. We also know, because he said it, that Consensus and J.P. Morgan were the drivers of the Ethereum Alliance from the very beginning. That's what he said. It's not what I said. That's why all this goes together in my mind. That's why it just popped in my head. Then Crypto Law, John Deaton's law firm, had tweeted this out, because today there was an article going around about how Consensus was raising money. And this is a quote from the article in the Financial Times. Lubin has mostly self-funded Consensus with his personal holdings of Ether, the digital asset associated with Ethereum. Pretty interesting. Then I went and I found this today, two clips. Here's the first one from April 5th, 2018, just a couple of months before the Hinman speech. This is Valerie Chepinick, okay? She's the one that is at the SEC. Listen up.
Is there room for more guidance or more clarity, or do you think what we have currently is sufficient?
The securities laws are very broad and principles-based, and I think if you were to start down the road of being very prescriptive and putting out specific releases about hypothetical situations, not only would you probably waste a lot of time, but you would probably create a roadmap to get around it, and at the same time, encourage kind of a form over substance approach to things. I mean, you might actually cut off what would be a helpful technology by steering the direction of the industry in one way or the other. So what we've done instead, and I think it's been very productive, is to have, with the announcement of the DAO, we also announced our FinTech Hub, which is essentially a mailbox where people can write in, and anyone literally can ask for an audience with folks with the SEC and its various divisions and offices, and sit down and talk to people about their proposed use case. And what we found is a lot of people are curious and they come in and they don't have very well-formulated ideas. So it would be very difficult for us in those situations to give someone a green light here, a green light there, when none of the specifics have been worked out. And the securities laws, even though they're broad, the conduct that we regulate has to, for example, an exchange, if you're looking at whether something acts as an exchange, there's a very specific definition. So we have to understand what your use case is and the mechanics behind it before we can tell you something about it. I mean, we can't give advice, but we can certainly guide people in the right direction. And it has been very productive. People come in and they tell us their ideas. We say, have you thought about this? Have you thought about that? And then we go back to the drawing board and look at it a different way. And we found, I think, an increasing sophistication in the folks that are coming to us, and their ideas are more formulated. And on top of that, the SEC's always had exemptive type relief or no action type relief. So if folks get to the point where they actually have a system that they want to propose and get some kind of pronouncement about, they have a mechanism to do that already.
Okay. And then John Deaton weighed in on this. He said, this is the SEC's crypto czar. We can't give advice, but we can certainly guide people in the right direction. The SEC didn't guide Coinbase in the right direction of not listing XRP when Coinbase met with the SEC in January 2019 and informed the SEC that it planned to list XRP. And so, this is bizarre, folks. They're basically saying, we can't give a rule. She said in that clip something to the effect of, well, we don't want to make a rule because then people might be able to figure out how to get around it. In other words, we won't be in a position to set a trap for you. That's bizarre. This is just, I was on the phone with somebody a few minutes ago and I was telling them, this whole thing is just so bizarre because there's no truth in all this. It's all beat. It's like that guy Ryan Selka said earlier in that video. I said, it's all bullshit. These people, I mean, what they're doing is they're dancing. I mean, I don't know how those SEC attorneys can go into that Ripple lawsuit in front of that judge with a straight face without being just embarrassed or scared to death that they're going to get screamed at and yelled out of the room. I can't even imagine trying to go and defend the indefensible. Now, I had another clip, but I'm going to skip that one. I'm going to skip over that one. It's not as good as the first one. I did want to show you this, though. This is 6 days before the Safe Harbor memo is sent to the SEC, the memo that became the Hinman speech or inspired the Hinman speech. This goes to the CFTC. It's a letter from Consensus, March 20th, 2018. And I wanted to show you this part. In collaboration with the Cardozo Law School Blockchain Project, Consensus also leads the Brooklyn Project, an industry-wide initiative to promote a responsible and consumer-friendly virtual token economy. BKP is an open and transparent initiative. It wasn't too open and transparent because they were trying to hide all these memos. The memos leaked. Remember that. So if they were being too transparent, then the memos wouldn't have leaked, right? Okay. Open and transparent initiative that encourages market participation. We are currently collaborating with approximately 1,000 participants who represent a broad cross-section of the players in blockchain and crypto markets, including but not limited to lawyers, regulators, developers, entrepreneurs, consumers, enthusiasts. So this is what Charles Gasparino, remember, they're sending this letter to the CFTC. Charles Gasparino report, when he did that report in May of 2018, he said that it was SEC sanctioned, and he said they were working with the SEC and the CFTC. Here's what I thought was interesting in this letter that these guys are writing the CFTC. The language, now remember, these are a couple of attorneys from Consensus, but they're talking to the CFTC almost as if they're telling them what they're going to do. This line right here caught my attention. The CFTC should clearly state that this proposal is not applicable and will not be applicable in the context of determining whether a virtual currency was delivered in the spot markets. Where such, anyway, it's like they're telling them, here's what you need to do, and da-da-da-da. Anyway, so, but here, I want to show you who wrote it, because we've shown videos of both of them. Joyce Lai and Matt Corva, they were the two of the Consensus attorneys that wrote that letter to the CFTC. Then I got this, this guy, King Houston, sent me some video of Hester Pierce at the recent Texas Blockchain Summit. Listen to this.
Are we catching bad actors or creating a catch-22? The good actors want to know which digital assets are securities. They want to know what the rules are so that they can comply with those rules. But during my 4 years, nearly 4 years at the commission, we've done little to explain what those rules should look like. I lay the blame on myself and on my colleagues on the commission. We simply haven't allowed the staff the room that they need to really sit down and think through the difficult issues around how, if these things are, or some of these things are securities, how that is going to look, how are these entities going to be able to comply with those regulations. We need to do something other than simply drag people in through enforcement actions and force them to go through that process. We need to sit down and come up with a regulatory framework that makes a difference.
All right. And then there's this clip. Check this out. Another great clip. This is who needs to be running the SEC.
But it really doesn't matter what I think or what my fellow regulators think. What matters, and I think this is really important, is what you think, what the public thinks, what the people want. Regulators easily forget that, but our directives should be coming from the people up, not from the regulator down. And so I hope that we will really work on building a sensible regulatory framework.
All right.
But it really doesn't matter.
I wanted to show you just something real quick here. Remember this? This is from April 19th, 2018, and it's written by Nathaniel Popper. This is the guy who, when the Safe Harbor memo leaked, or when it leaked that this was going on, he's the one that broke the story in the New York Times. Well, here's what's interesting. This is a tweet by him 14 days after Ethereum got its free pass. And I was saying very interesting people on this list, and here's why. Just about everybody on the list has to do with proof of work, okay? And remember, Nathaniel Popper, I don't know if you'd call him Bitcoin or Ethereum, but he's no fan of Ripple like most of these guys. The people he names in this are interesting. One is Amber Baldet. That's the girl that ran JP Morgan's blockchain. She's the originator, my understanding, of JP Morgan Coin and the Quorum project. Okay. Then you have some other people. Of course, you got Vitalik Buterin. It's interesting that he names Chris Dixon, because Chris Dixon is the guy at Andreessen Horowitz that Jay Clayton put in charge of going and putting the venture capital working group together and gathering up the industry players. And then you've got Mike Novogratz on the list. You've got Valerie Chapanik from over there at the SEC that I just showed you. You got this guy, Jihan Wu. That's the guy that runs Bitmain. That's the mining company. That was that. Wasn't it out of China, I believe? And then, interestingly, you've got Jed McCaleb, the man who has never been touched by any law enforcement. The man who came from Mt. Gox, then started Ripple, then goes and starts Stellar. And he's nowhere in any, the authorities are never talking to him about anything, as far as I can tell. Okay, next, the official Cool Gob, the Digital Asset Investor channel, sent me this from iTrustCapital. You ask, we deliver. iTrustCapital has announced Songbird support, okay? And I don't think it's going to be available to trade, but you're going to get your Songbird. That's the important thing with this. And I'm not sure the winds of it and all that. Also wanted to make you aware that iTrustCapital is one of my sponsors. Link2 is another one. And Link2 added some Ripple equity. They added some Link2. And it's interesting, Link2, when I first saw Link2, I can't remember if it was 10 cents or 40 cents, but it's now at $2.50. Anyway. Then they Uphold is fully subscribed. There's some Kraken. I'm just looking at the blockchain stuff. There's some Ripple and there's some Link2. Anyway, you have to be an accredited investor, and it's linqto.com. Now, I'm the digital asset investor. I'm not an investment advisor. This is for entertainment purposes only. Please subscribe, hit the like button, and tell your friends and family that Link2 and Ripple, or there's some Ripple equity that's up on the platform here, and Link2 equity too. And some Kraken. So check it out. Or if you don't know if you're an accredited investor, these guys can help you find out. So go and talk to them.